Hey guys, it's Lizzie. So today I'm filming outside at this park by my house, and I have my infused water right here. I put frozen blueberries and frozen strawberries in it, and it's so yummy. I do this just to force myself to drink more water because water gets really boring after a while, so I always drink tea or lemon and fruit flavored water just to like get myself to stay hydrated. Today I'm doing a long awaited Ask Lizzie video. I have not filmed one in almost a year, and I realized that the other day when I was like looking through my old videos, and I was like, oh no, I need to do an update video. I've just been writing so many articles, my opinion on different things happening in the news, different Bible verses, me analyzing, talking about different stories that have happened in my life. It's really personal, it's like a diary, so if you want to be on like a best friend status where I'm like sharing all my secrets about my life with you, then go read my website. Cameron! Hi! I miss you! This is one of my friends from my school. So I'm leaving in mid-January. I'm supposed to be spending the rest of this year kind of doing like rehab at my house to kind of get my brain completely balanced, and it's just proving to be very difficult because with bipolar, it's very common for like us to just like stop taking medicine, stop doing treatment, knowing that part of the way you've experienced the world has been the result of an episode. And I'm kind of getting to a point now where I'm realizing that that is me. Like, bipolar is me. It's a part of me, and it's a good part of me, even though it can sometimes get out of control. And so, but even with that mindset, that the symptoms are just like an extremity of something that's already me, it's still, it's very difficult to completely submit to treatment. So that's why I'm still in America right now. No, I do not get frustrated by my progress at all. I get like so inspired by my progress. I don't know what workout routine you're doing, though. Right now I've been doing Kayla Itzine's BBG, Bikini Body Guide, and I'm amazed by my progress. After like 2 weeks of the arms workouts, I could do like 15 push-ups just like straight, like regular push-ups. What's really important is to not focus on losing weight, but to focus on strength. When I focus on strength, I get really excited. I never weigh myself. I do miss my friends from it the most. That's what I miss the most. And I guess I also miss getting to just do research all the time, because I think, like, since I'm home, you know, I'm able to do research on my own, and I have been, but you feel more motivated to read and to research when you're doing it with a class, and when there's a syllabus and when there's deadlines, like the professor motivates you to like get stuff done and guides you towards like what to research. And so I miss that a lot. And I think like the most though, I miss philosophy classes, because you get to like dialogue with people about ideas, and it's difficult to do philosophy on your own. Like, you can't dialogue with other people, and that's really sad. So I guess I do miss philosophy classes the most of anything from Pepperdine. This is so exciting. I have friends there right now. I wish you could. Okay, so number one, go to Zuma Beach and go to Sun Life. Get an acai bowl from Sun Life and go to Heroes Garden. It's like up at the very top of the hill by the grad school. It has a beautiful view. Go there at sunset and it'll just be amazing. Like, so when you sit down and you look out at the water, it looks like the water is falling into the ocean. It's really pretty. And then also go to Alumni Park and have a Bible study there. Just like bring your Bible and your journal, just like pray there and talk to God on Alumni Park. I do that all the time. And also go behind the chapel. Go behind the chapel, has this outlook looking out into the ocean, and go pray there too. It's amazing. And go look at the chapel during the day because the light streams in and it's so beautiful. And yeah, one of my friends is about to get married at the chapel, and it's gonna be the most beautiful ceremony ever. It's like, it's so beautiful. Could tell you what you wanna hear, cause the truth is always in the way. Definitely not. I need to make a whole video on this. I promise I will. I'll link it below when I do, if you're watching this later. I think forgiving has to do with your attitude towards that person internally. So not hating them is an example of forgiveness. But then whether or not they're in your life, thing. The first time someone hurts me, does something really out of line, like they yell at me or something, that's a good example. If someone yells at me, the first time I'll sit down with them and be like, okay, like this is completely unacceptable. I don't put up with this in relationships. This is abusive. If you do this again, we're gonna take a break in our friendship. And then the second time that happens, I will like seriously start thinking about ending the friendship or like cutting the person out of my life, just because it's really abusive. And then if it happened a third time, that would be kind of be the end of it. And I'm not saying like the end in the sense that I'm never going to talk to this person again, but we're going to take, you know, like a few weeks, a month off of our friendship. Or you're going to have a third person come and kind of mediate and like sit down with them and have like a really honest conversation about what is completely unacceptable in like the way they're abusing you in the friendship. And so I'd say if you think that you could have a mediation session and they can really, really figure things out and like decide what to do differently, I think that could be enough. But if that's not enough, then I think it's totally good. It's a good thing to cut someone out of your life temporarily, because otherwise you're teaching them that they're abusing you and you're saying, no, that's not okay. They keep abusing you and you keep letting it happen. And that's turning into something really unhealthy for them too. And so I think it's really important to just tell people that, you know, you're not gonna allow that in your life anymore. And that's like the best way to love people, because when you're enabling them, you're allowing all this hate and like out of control bitterness to build up in them. And so it's really good if you're really firm about like not letting them into your life again. And I think that that has nothing to do with forgiveness. Like, forgiveness has to do with your attitude towards them, how you're treating them. You can treat them with love when they're not in your life. Like, you can think about them in a positive way. You can pray a lot for them when they're not in your life. But when their actions are just becoming really toxic, like, you have to get out. You can't let them continue treating you like that.
When it feels like surgery and it burns like third degree, and you wonder, what is it worth?
Videos do. Oh, that makes me happy. Have a great rest of your summer. You too. I hope your summer is very like flourishing and you can really grow and like learn more about who you are. With depression and with major depression, general anxiety disorder, stuff like that, it's not in your control. And so you'll have thoughts about like your worth, or like you're worried about something, because I have anxiety in my depression sometimes too, and it's just like thoughts that happen, and it's not you creating them, it's not you like thinking it, it just happens, it's involuntary. And so the best way to deal with that is to address it to what I do. I've been off medicine lately just because I'm trying to figure out like the right, just because I go off my medicine randomly because I have bipolar, and that's normal for people with bipolar. It's really bad, but I do it a lot. I don't know why. But anyway, so I'm off medicine now. And so I have, you know, mood episodes, and I have mixed episodes and stuff. And I have thoughts sometimes that are really negative about myself, and they're not true. And so since I'm not on medicine and I know I'm in, you know, a bit of a depression episode at the time, I'll be like, this is because of my depression episode. And I'll identify it in my mind. And when I identify it as the disorder and not as me thinking it, not as something that's true to myself, then it doesn't affect me as much. And so I guess just become really self-aware of when you're in an episode and what that feels like, and when the thoughts start coming that aren't real, that aren't your thoughts, then just address it as not your thought, and then pray about it. Pray that that won't like affect who you are, how you think about yourself. Working out a lot and exercising, you know, I talk about health in so many of my videos. I'm really into eating healthy. I'm really into working out every day, 6 times a week, not every day. You need to rest sometimes. But all of that, also sleep. I'm gonna link a video right here that I made about sleep and below. Sleep is so important, and it's like the number one thing that will help your depression or anxiety like not be as bad. It's less about like what you're thinking, but more about just like dealing with like the underlying like neuron problem. And so what I found is to really just make it a priority to stay healthy in every area of my life, and when that happens, then the symptoms are not as bad. This book, it's called The Circle Maker, and it talks about prayer. And this book, like, I had the whole thing like annotated so much. It just, it brings a ton of Bible passages into like a different context. And it just basically, it talks about how you should pray persistently and how that's how God works in the world. He works when like there's a problem. He doesn't just like intervene to fix the problem. He waits for his people to like cry out to him and then he intervenes. So it's kind of like we have to tap into this like spiritual energy. I feel like I'm some new age person talking. Tap into the spiritual energy. But yeah, God's spirit works when we're interceding in a situation. That's how it's always been, and that's how it should be now. And so this book has just gotten me to pray really persistently, intensely for friends, for people in my life, for situations, and I've seen so much amazing stuff happen through that. I've seen so much of God's power. So this book changed my life, and then changed my prayer life, definitely. And this book is called Christianity and Politics, A Brief Guide to the History by C.G. Pecknold. this is a textbook, correct, but it's not boring. This book is probably more exciting than a Christian living book because it's telling a real story. It's talking about, this is all about the early church. I annotated, I don't know if you guys can tell, but I annotated, I highlighted all over this book. It's amazing. This completely changed the way I read the Bible and think about my faith. I think about this book during when I'm taking communion. I think about this book when I'm reading any part of the Bible, thinking of the early church. It talks about how Jesus, I don't know how to explain the book without like explaining the entire book, but this basically talks about how Jesus being the Son of God, it's not weird that he was calling himself, claiming to be a Son of God, because at the time, like the emperor's son is the Son of God, the emperor was God, like they thought of things in that context. But then Jesus was a peasant, he was a poor man, he was in like the lowest of social classes, and he is called the Son of God, and that is like just like bizarre to them. And then Jesus was making a political statement through his ministry, because theology and politics and philosophy were all like the same concept at the time. And see, I'm saying these things and they seem really like, what do you mean? And like, you need to read this book. It changed the way I think about my faith, and it's really simple. Like for a intellectual like school book, it's so easy to read, like so easy to read. Like you just need to read this book. And this is like my favorite class I took at Pepperdine with Professor Blakely. It's called Christian Political Thought, and it changed the way I think about my faith like so much. This is another book that I really love, and I'm gonna make a whole video soon talking about all my favorite Christian living books. It's just gonna be like a really long video. This is called The Best Yes. And it was, this guy randomly gave it to me. It was really weird, like we barely even knew each other, and he's just like, here, like read this book, you need to read this book. It was perfect timing. Right when I was going into depression, I was reading this book, and I was thinking about the past like few months or past year of doing ministry in my school, and how I had never said no to anything. I was always the person who'd said yes to everything. And this book talks about how it's okay to say no to helping people and to serving people, because if you say yes to everyone, you're just gonna get burnt out and drained out, and instead you should focus your energy towards something that only you can uniquely do, like strengthening your relationship with God. Only you can pray to God, only you can read your Bible for yourself. And so this book really, if you're someone who overcommits, it teaches you how to plan out your life and how it's actually a godly thing to say no to people. I see we're talking about my college. It was just kind of a Christian bubble, I'd say, and then it was like a family. Like it was kind of like everyone you interacted with was very loving, like all the staff, all the professors, my friends at the school, the people I knew at school. It was very utopian, like the communities I was in. Like I get culture shocked when I leave Pepperdine, because everyone isn't just like very loving and like looking out for you and wanting to be like really kind, and that's how it was there. Like everyone was just so loving. I just felt like I got kind of a glimpse into like what a Christian city is like, and that's what it was. It was like a little city of Christianity. So those are all of the questions that I wanted to include in this video. I hope that you found something in this helpful or it made you think differently about your life. I have a section on my website called Thailand. I'm gonna link it below. Go check it out. I actually need help going to Thailand, as in I need funding, I need money, because the church is not paying me, because I'm going over as a missionary, so I am getting my own support. I just edited my website. Well, I'm always editing my website, putting new things on it, but there's a new tab on my website called Thailand. So if you go to LizziesAnswers.com/Thailand, that page is going to be all about like my plans for when I'm leaving there, my fundraising. There's just like a breakdown of what I'm going to be spending money on, kind of like my budget for when I'm over there, explanations of what I'm going to be doing for ministry, where I'll be living, just like all of those questions are answered on there. There's a way where you can donate money to me, and so I'm going over for a few years. I'm going to keep everyone updated through my YouTube channel and my vlog channel. I actually restarted on my vlog channel. I made a video. You should go watch it. I'm going to be vlogging when I'm over there a lot to kind of like show you what I'm doing, but also I'm just going to be like talking about it with pictures. Updates will be on that part of my website. I'm really, really excited that it's like all becoming real now, and I'm really happy that I get to like continue my YouTube when I'm over there, just like bring everyone along, because it'll be so fun. You guys will like get to see my whole life while I'm over there. So that is all for this video. I love you all so much, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye.